Back again, Burt Reynolds in a commanding lead with $14.
Hey, check out the podium. Look at this.
Mr. Reynolds has apparently changed his name to Turd Ferguson.
Yeah, that's right. Turd Ferguson. It's a funny name.
And I'm looking at him because I know there's more. And I wait and wait, and I see the glimmer in the eye, and then bang! I thought you were going to, but no. But what's the movie going to be called?
Well, really? I know what it's going to be called.
Yeah, what's that?
If it's got Carrot Top in it, you know what a good name for it would be?
What's that, Norm?
Box Office Poison.
Do you want to read it?
Why would I want to read it?
Well, because you never get to read them.
Get to read them? Like it's a big... I don't give a shit about any of this.
So you just want me to read it?
I don't care if you shove it up your asshole. Ah! I'd like to solve the puzzle, Alex.
This isn't Wheel of Fortune.
Who is Andre the Giant?
Is that an answer to a question?
No, I was just wondering who is Andre the Giant.
Who disrupts my coronation?
Everyone has been destroyed because of this freak. I won't allow it! These babies just saved this lame fest party!
Guys, what's going on? You are listening to This Week in Geek, and I'm your host, Mike the Birdman, but I'm not alone as I travel through the Canadian wilderness armed with a hatchet and poutine. I'm joined by the man in Kitchener.
Alex, the producer.
So, yes, guys, it has been an exciting week for me here up in the wonderful lands of Ontario, Canada. Where do I even begin to start? First, try making national news at one point. Earlier this week, I went out to my first ride that wasn't going to a hospital. So I took a cab ride over to a local city where Alex lives, Kitchener, and I attended a NDP rally, which was really cool. And the reason I went to this particular one is because the NDP leader, Yagmeet Singh, the man in the turban, was going to be there, and I actually got a chance to ask him some very direct questions. If you want to go see what I asked, it's available on my Facebook, or it's not on my Facebook, on my Twitter and Instagram and on my TikTok. And a lot of people are super, super supportive. Some not so much, but we're not going to feed the trolls.
Everybody has haters. Even if, are you really surprised that asking questions about disability would have some people be like, screw disabled people, screw indigenous people?
I was honestly surprised. Although one guy
Here's a question. How many of them are Canadian?
That I don't know, because there's a few that I think are just bot accounts because they have no videos, no followers, yet an aggressive anti-messaging thing. So I was like, okay. But a lot of the support from the disabled community has been fantastic. And then there's one person on Reddit who, because I posted the video over there as well, was saying there aren't millions of Canadians and then who are disabled. Then I found a study that said, yes, there are. Here's the official government stats. He's like, oh my God, I had no idea. I'm like, yeah.
It's isn't it about 300,000 or 400,000 in Ontario alone?
Oh, it's way higher.
I think it was,
than that.
Or no, but the people that are currently receiving ODSP, it's like 500.
Way more than that, dude. We're talking hundreds of thousands. It's a lot.
Okay,
but
well, I mean, well, think about it.
It's not something people think about.
A country of what, 36 million, roughly?
Yep. And I think
so. You figure if perhaps 800, you'd figure maybe.
I think the
not 10%, probably like 3 to 5% of the country might be disabled. And if you go by numbers based on
closer to 20, actually.
20%?
Yeah, that number. Because you're also counting people that are above the age of 60 who are experiencing trouble. You're including the mentally disabled or other people who have
and they're also mental health people issues. People that are in the workforce but still have disability supports.
Yes, exactly. So this guy, he was like, oh my God, I had no idea. And then another woman is like, I didn't think I'd ever have it happen to me too, but my husband was in a motorcycle accident and now this has happened to us too. So thank you for asking these questions, and people are talking. So maybe I made a positive change, and that's been really life affirming as well. So that was fantastic.
Yeah. And even if you don't get the answers you're looking for, the fact that the question was asked is important too.
Yeah. Like a lot of people were saying I did better than some moderators in any of the debates because I wanted a straight answer and I wasn't going to stop until I got it.
Especially since the debates, which there was only two this time, one French, one English, were just essentially devolved into American, you know, spewing hate at each other kind of debates that we're used to seeing in American politics, but not here.
Yeah, it wasn't as productive as I would have liked. And then the other big event that happened this week is my sister, Katie came up from Montreal. This is the second time that I have met her face to face. She's been working the elections and took a couple days off to come and visit. And then that came with its own unique set of emotionally challenging things, because on Friday night, we were given the opportunity to speak to my real dad via video chat because we got hooked up through his sister. And me and Katie got the talk on video in real time with my dad. And they had taken a screenshot when we were having the conversation. And I finally saw my own face in somebody else. And it was different looking at Katie, looking at my father, David. And it was very, very spiritual to see that.
It's one thing to know on paper that you have people that are biologically related to you. It's another thing to come to that realization in physically seeing the genetics.
Yeah. Like, and just the fact that I didn't know who my dad was for essentially 30 something years. And it's only come to light in the last couple that this is real. And he was supposed to come out, but obviously because of COVID, he also raises puppies. He's hoping to come out next spring. There's talk of us going on a family fishing trip to my old hometown area. And it looks like it's going to be a lot of fun. And it just,
you don't need a fishing license either, do you? Because Native Affairs card.
I'm not sure how that works now, but I know if I go up to the reservation, there's no big deal.
Because I remember, wasn't that something like you need a fishing game card if you're Canadian, I would say not blood native, but like I remember always hearing that like there was that you guys were allowed to fish and hunt on any grounds that were considered like traditional hunting grounds or something
like that. It's not something I kept a lot up in because I'm obviously not of that particular hobby, but I do enjoy fishing. So I also got a rather entertaining story out of my father how he went fishing out of season and it didn't end so well for him, which that was kind of funny. But yeah, I mean, it was really, 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 really fun. And then we spent some time together. We watched a bunch of movies. We had a chance to see the movie Malignant. And I'm just going to say this. There's one scene in that movie where I was rolling, laughing, falling out of my wheelchair, hysterical laughing. It turns into the Matrix lobby scene, but with gore. Oh,
I saw bits and pieces of that from the Red Letter Media review, and it doesn't, I don't know the story, but it looked like she had like a possessed, like semi-grown twin growing out of the back of her head that controlled her and made her fight like the Matrix, but backwards.
It's strange. I don't want to give away the big reveal. I was with that movie up until about the last 30 minutes, and then it became laugh a minute hysterical.
Because I'm hearing people say things that it's like, this is the next room, the room, or that this is basically what Troma would make if they had a budget.
actually, yeah, I don't disagree with that assessment. But yeah, so that was a fun thing. So me and Katie and Blair watched that, had a good time. That was fun, kind of bonding over that. And then finally, Katie asked me to show her a really good video game because she's only seen stuff on her computer. She used to play WoW and everything. She hasn't kept up with like current consoles. So I showed her Ghost of Tsushima Director's Cut on PlayStation 5. And I unfortunately picked the most emotionally challenging mission for me. I showed her there's a warrior monk named Norio. And as you get to the end of his tales, I'm not going to reveal exactly what happens. For me, it hit me like a gut punch because I didn't see it coming.
He's like a young, naive mixture of, I don't remember his name, but the sidekick from Doctor Strange.
Wong, yeah.
A mixture of him and the sidekick friend from the new Spider-Man.
Yeah, and it was
he's a very naive but friendly monk, and he has to go through some shit where you're like, damn.
Yeah, like when he comes to his emotional arc conclusion in that moment, it was very spiritually, I don't even know what the word is. I would call it challenging. So over the last day or so, I've been talking with Alex and a few other people saying, you know what? I need to step away from Ghost of Tsushima. I finally rolled credits. Now I'm moving on to the expansion. I'm thinking, you know what? I need to go visit Commander Shepard and go fight the Reapers for a while.
And I did reassure you before we recorded that the expansion, while emotional, is not as dark or heavy.
Yeah, like I need a break. I haven't felt this emotionally drained since Persona 5.
Oh, wait, what about Last of Us Part 2?
Oh, shut up.
Wait, sorry, I'm bringing up a traumatic, repressed memory.
It really is, but hey, I love games that make me feel like that. So
make you feel and make you think, that's what I look for.
Mm-hmm. So what about you? What has your week been like?
It was a rather Alex is an old man and sore week, where I was like, why is my body betraying me? And it's because of the crazy humidity and then off and on. So I spent a couple nights where I was just like, I'm having Tylenol and a weed gummy. And that helped me sleep like a baby.
Good.
Because I had not slept like that in a while. I almost made the mistake of eating a 250 gram THC edible.
You'd still be asleep now.
Yeah. So I it's in the shape of a maple leaf, and I ate a tip of the leaf. So that should have been about 20 milligrams, and that was perfect because that would have been interesting. You would have received a phone call at 2 a.m. going, I think I've died. Please send help. Send help because I can't stop shaking or the room's shaking. But yes, gaming wise, I spent the time catching up on some games that I was sent for review that will be coming out in the next few weeks. Death Stranding Director's Cut. Also, I was playing more and more Cruis'n Blast, which I believe we're having in this week's show.
Yes.
Same there, and as well as Super Monkey Ball. And that should be sometime by the end of the month. I'll have a review out for that. Catching up on TV shows that I've wanted to start watching. Just bits and pieces here and there. I did go and see the new Clint Eastwood movie, which was incredibly boring. But you kind of like have to go see his movies now because at 91 years old, every movie is very likely his last movie.
Pretty much. Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, and it was weird because he's 91, but he was playing a guy who was supposed to be in his like 60s, I think. And like still like strong and virile and all this. And he has like these ladies that are in their 40s and 50s hitting on him. And it looked like if your great grandfather is hitting on your sister.
Ew.
Yeah, and there's a part where he's supposed to be riding a horse and they use a stunt double where they cover his face the whole time because they're like, he's 91, he ain't getting on a horse, he looks feeble.
Because one bad fall and he's gonna break a hip and never know what'll happen.
And I'm not saying all 91 year olds are like that, because Shatner's turning 91 and Shatner breaks in horses and rides them still like every day. But like certain people have that energy and stamina. It's very rare at that age, but he ain't no Shatner when it comes to stamina. Let's just say that he looked like he was going to fall out of the car when he was driving. But his directing was good. Movie was really boring though. But I saw that, and then it's been just a whole lot of sort of recovering and recuperating because it's been kind of crazy with the weather out, like storm after storm of hail and tornadoes and hot and then randomly cold and then hot again and it's. I've needed a palate cleanser, so that's why I was playing all these, you know, smaller games like Monkey Ball and all that. So I'm getting prepared for what we fully expect to be a very busy October and early November.
Yeah, it's going to be a sprint to the finish, which, like I said, our last show should be December 12th, which will be our annual holiday gift guide. We should have a Christmas commentary coming out on Christmas Day. Be looking for that. And then any syndicated content we record before then. So coming up in this show, however, we got a lot of really, really cool stuff. We have a review of WarioWare Get It Together on the Nintendo Switch. We also, as you mentioned, Cruis'n Blast, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Yeah, we'll be taking a look at that. And then finally, me and Alex have an extended discussion of Star Trek on 4K, and that's going to be the original 4 movie collection. That comes to us from Paramount Home Entertainment. Look for that in the middle of the show. Plus, weirdness from the entertainment industry, as you heard off the beginning of the show. Rest in peace, Turd Ferguson. But we're also going to be talking about people who steal cryogenically frozen brains. And
box office poison. That's still my favorite late night clip ever.
So we will be talking about all this and more right here on ThisWeekInGeek.net. Thank you for joining us over the last 14 to 15 years. I've lost count at this point. We'll be back, guys, right after we, well, get it together. This is WarioWare Get It Together on the Nintendo Switch. Hey guys, this is Mike the Birdman here, and I'm here to talk about something that we got for review from Nintendo. We're going to be talking about WarioWare Get It Together on the Nintendo Switch. A review code was provided to us. So I've been a huge fan of this franchise since I first remember playing it. I want to say on the Nintendo Wii, and I think I played some of the handheld entries over my years as a game critic. And I'm a big fan of it because they are short little mini games that challenge you to think weird, but they're always super simple. You're never going to get hung up on, you know, this is too challenging. They're meant to be played simple. It's the ultimate party game, but it also is the ultimate experience in weirdness. And it's one of those Nintendo franchises that I'm surprised is as successful as it is because it's not as complex and competitive as, say, Mario Party. And it's its own unique beast. It's kind of fun. Like, this would be awesome for mobile phones, but I'm really glad that this is on the Switch and you can have this as a party game with up to 4 players. So there are, like, what I feel like are hundreds of minigames on here. I think I've read there's over, like, 200. I've only unlocked what you can do through the storyline, which is quite a bit. And then some of those you have to replay certain things to unlock more variations of certain games, like Slice of Life, Food, NES Classics is where I spent most of my time. There's stuff from Fire Emblem, Animal Crossing, Super Mario World, where you literally play one of the levels from Super Mario World, which is really, really cool. And then there's ones like Devil World. There's like a Game & Watch one. But there's also ones like, hey, shove yourself up this guy's nose. Here, turn on this hand sanitizer thing. Make these two people kiss. Here's a giant magnet thing. And there's just a really bizarre set of circumstances that you have to compete with up to 20 unlockable characters that you unlock through the course of the storyline. And then the epilogue, which kind of happens at the end, where you collect a golden toilet paper thing and a beehive. It's weird. It makes sense in the grand scheme of things. Just trust me on that one. And then you can play, like I said, this with up to 4 people. Now, the cool thing about this one that I really like is there are an actual story mode where you basically are Wario and you have all the guys who work with you to create the WarioWare game. But now there's this big game-breaking bug thing that has infected all the game worlds and trapped your friends inside. So it's up to you to go in there and rescue them. And I didn't realize that Wario was this He's just kind of a greedy jerk. I wouldn't call him evil. Opportunistic at best, and I think that's how he's been kind of played up, I guess, in recent years. My first experience with Wario was, I want to say, Super Mario Land 2 and the 6 golden coins, if I remember right. But this is a wonderful collection of just fast, frantic, and insane minigames that I didn't think would be as fun as it was, and I'm really glad that I had a chance to kind of play with it. And there's so much customization where you can buy items with the coins you generate in-game, and then you can give those to your friends in like a customization menu and unlock different color options. You can unlock artwork. There's like an online competitive mode, which is like called the Wario Cup. And there's like the Playopedia, which shows you everything you've unlocked so far and how much you still have to go. And it's a lot here. And I really think WarioWare Get It Together is one of those titles where if you don't have a very long attention span and you're just looking for something to kill a little bit of time, like you don't want to get committed to anything for longer than 5 or 10 minutes, hell, this is a great thing to play on your commute on the bus or subway or something like that. Or literally like, I got 5 minutes to kill, I'll throw this on and you're gonna have a pretty great time. Overall, WarioWare Get It Together for the Nintendo Switch, it's some of the most fun I've had on the system this year. And as someone who wasn't a big Switch aficionado over the last couple of years, games like this make me want to play my Switch more. And I'm really glad that I got a chance to play this. So big thank you to Nintendo for sending this over. And I really hope we continue to see more of Wario and his friends. It would be really cool if they release a DLC pack that would give you more games. But like I said, there's a lot here. So it's going to take a while for you to unlock everything. But I think you're going to have a fun time doing it no matter what.
The Prime Minister of Sweden visited Washington today, and my tiny little nipples went to France.
Gossip, rumors, panic in the streets. We're lucky.
This Week in Geek
News.
And welcome back to ThisWeekInGeek.net. I'm your host, Mike the Birdman, joined with Alex, the producer. Well, we're going to start things off with, like I said, at the top of the show, you heard a funny bit from comedian Norm Macdonald, who is unfortunately no longer with us. So according to Deadline and multiple outlets around the world, Norm Macdonald, influential comedian and former SNL Weekend Update anchor, has passed away. He was 61 years old. So according to Deadline, Norm Macdonald, whose iconic delivery of sharp, incisive observations made him one of Saturday Night Live's most influential and beloved cast members, died last week after a 9-year private battle with cancer. He was 61. McDonald's death was announced to Deadline by his management firm, Brillstein Entertainment. The comedian's longtime producing partner and friend, Lori Jo Hoekstra, was with him when he died and said McDonald had been battling cancer for nearly a decade, but was determined to keep his health struggles private, away from family, friends, and fans. He was the most proud of his comedy, Hoekstra said. He never wanted the diagnosis to affect the way the audience or any of his loved ones saw him. Norm was a pure comic. He once wrote that a joke should catch someone by surprise. It should never pander. He certainly never pandered. Norm will be missed terribly. Norm Macdonald was scheduled to be in the New York City Comedy Festival lineup in November. He was an SNL cast member from 1993 to 1998, making his greatest impact as the anchor of the show's Weekend Update segments for 3 seasons. Remembered for his droll style and his refusal to go easy on O.J. Simpson, despite reported pressure from NBC executives, McDonald would prove one of his most impactful update anchors, pivoting away from the slapstick approach of Chevy Chase towards the more barbed political approach of his successor, Colin Quinn, who I thought was actually pretty funny too.
I always liked Dennis Miller as well.
Mm-hmm. Born on October 17th, 1959 in Quebec City, McDonald started his show business career in the comedy clubs of Canada, developing his deadpan style that would become both his trademark and highly influential touchstone for generations of comics. After being a contestant on Star Search in 1990, he had landed his first regular TV writing gig on The Dennis Miller Show, fronted by the man who anchored Weekend Update from 1986 to 1991. McDonald was hired to write for Roseanne Barr's sitcom Roseanne from 1992 to 1993 season before landing the coveted gig at NBC Saturday Night Live. Among his most popular SNL bits was a gum chewing or sorry, a gum chomping impression of Burt Reynolds, complete with charming smile, bolo tie, and wise guy attitude, often at hilarious odds with Will Ferrell's Alex Trebek. If his Reynolds was his best, other impressions were nearly on par. McDonald's roster included Andy Rooney, Clint Eastwood, David Letterman, Larry King, Quentin Tarantino, Mr. Bean, and Rod Sterling, among others. McDonald's departure from the show was controversial in itself, and the firing was often attributed to his continued lambasting of Simpson as a murderer, despite what had been said to, or sorry, despite what was said to be to the displeasure of Don Olemeyer, president of NBC's West Coast division, a friend of the former football great. McDonald would never, or sorry, would later tell the New York Times that he believed his dismissal was the result of doing experimental stuff, non sequiturs on Update, saying Olemeyer would watch Leno kill every night for 15 minutes, every joke, huge laugh, and then I'd do 10 minutes a week and sometimes get no laughs. Regardless of Olemeyer's motives, McDonald's was canned. His Simpson coverage unrivaled at the time for its comedic ferocity. While Leno routinely featured the silly dancing Itos during the trial, McDonald was relentless in his condemnations. The Simpson jury was still deliberating when he read the lead update item. They must now decide whether to free him or get all their heads cut off. After the not guilty verdict was rendered, he said, well, it's finally official. Murder is legal in the state of California. And then the article kind of goes on like this. I first saw McDonald. I started watching Saturday Night Live, I want to say about 94, 95. And he was one of my favorite bits just because it was that sharp, fast wit, but it was very observational. It wasn't played for, as they mentioned, slapstick comedy. And I love that type of humor because it was so deadpan and it was often hilarious.
Well, and it's also very anti-Canadian for the kind of humor that we usually have from our comedians. So he came up very differently. Like, it's very sarcastic, but also very deadpan. And he did something that a lot of comedians would never try to do, which is he would tell a joke that could be about 7 minutes long, where about 1 minute in, you knew where the what the punchline was going to be, but you had to sit through it to get him to say it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, and it would be something very offensive. Like, his a lot of his jokes ended with, you know, either gay jokes or something to that extent, and he would do things not just because, you know, he thought it was funny. He would do it sometimes to piss people off. If he was going to an event and they said, family only, you know, family friendly jokes here, please. Especially, like, I think he was banned from the state of Utah permanently. Yeah, there's a story Jim Brewer tells about it, where he was told to make it family friendly because, you know, Mormons and everything, right? Mm-hmm. And he opens up, the very first thing he says is, you know, what the fuck's with gay people, with to the mortification of the crowd, people covering their kids' ears, running out and everything, to the point where I believe it was the next day he was driven out of the state by state police, and the governor said, get him out, I don't ever want him back again.
Wow. I mean, like, obviously
I know it wasn't about, like, homophobia.
It was the shock factor.
The idea was these people are homophobic, fuck them.
So he was going to take them to task by showing them, this is how terrible you are.
Don't tell me what to do, one. Number two, you should know what my comedy is if you invite me.
Yeah.
And number three, who do you think you are? You think you're so much better? And then think about the notoriety. How many comedians can say since the 1950s were banned from a state?
I want to say there was like one or two, but not many. But yeah, like, Norm Macdonald's comedy was political, but it made sense. It was funny. It was in your face, but it was never, I don't know, I'm trying to figure out how I would describe it. It never talked down to you.
No, and even when he had his own podcast show and he had a Netflix show and all that with his interviews, he would purposely write bad jokes or terrible questions for the interviewers, because he loved to see how mad they would get when it was a bad interview. The worse the interview was, the more fun he seemed to have. Which, you know, if you were a friend of his, obviously they got it. But, like, you get people on there and they'd be like, I don't know what's going on. And he would double down on the terribleness, which is almost like, can you imagine your entire comedy later on in life is just, it's not just uncomfortable humor like Arrested Development or something, or like embarrassment humor. It's cringe for the sake of being cringe. And he seemed to, you know, love that. As far as what most of us probably would have seen him in post SNL, and if you weren't paying attention to
Dirty, you know, Work, Dirty Mike Tyson,
Mike Tyson Mysteries would be the one where he was the pigeon. And he basically, I think they gave him a basic bullet point, and he just made up whatever he wanted to in every scene.
And I think that's what made that character work.
Yeah, like he would see what the animation was or see what, and they just let him speak whatever he wanted to speak. And if they had to bleep him, they bleeped him. Like Dirty Work, I saw for the first time a couple of years ago and ended up loving it. But, you know, something I probably wouldn't have got as a kid. He did another one. Didn't he do one with, was it Chappelle? And
was he in Half Baked?
No,
I don't think so.
No, he's in Billy Madison. He's the friend.
Yes. Yeah. He always did a lot of collaborations with the Happy Madison
group. Early on. Yeah. And I think it was a movie called Screwed with.
Yes.
With Danny DeVito, Dave Chappelle and him. I haven't seen that one. That was his other big, like, I mean, big in quotes, Hollywood starring feature other than Dirty Work. But I would say, even though he's only in a few episodes, people probably remember him because you know how he did all those Burt Reynolds impressions, right? Mm-hmm. Well, and remember My Name is Earl?
Mm-hmm.
So the bad guy that ran the I think it was the strip club or something else, was Chubby. And that was played by Burt Reynolds in three episodes. And at one point after he dies, his son takes over, Little Chubby, and it's him doing his Burt Reynolds impression. Playing his son, you know, like a real wink and a nod at SNL, right?
One thing I found out, because I was following the conversation on Twitter when he passed away, is copies of Dirty Work on, I think on Bluray, are going for exorbitant prices right now. Like, I heard someone say, like, over $200.
Well, it was a small print run, I think, when they first did it. Like, and Screwed, I think, only has a DVD release. Like, if I look up Dirty Work just in Canada, because, I mean, you could import from the States, but I'm assuming it's probably even harder to find in the States right now. Yeah, like, Dirty Work, DVD and Blu-ray is completely sold out on Amazon. Like, gone. And then you think, okay, well, I think that's because that's the one people associate with him.
Mm-hmm.
Because that was his, when everybody in SNL was getting, like, a movie out, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was his break for that, and it didn't do well. But it became a cult classic of video. Screwed only has a DVD release, and it's completely sold out now, too. Not even used copies anywhere.
And I don't know whether you can stream these movies or not. So, obviously, it's a great loss to the comedy world. Like, he was supposed to appear at this festival in November. It's sad. Well, I mean,
and he's one of the few guys that in Canada, like, he didn't get famous or get noticed by going to the States and going to, like, a New York comedy club. He's one of the few guys that was a homegrown Yuck Yucks comedian. Mm-hmm. That was discovered through Yuck Yucks and through, like, the comedy festivals up here. And that's how, like, somebody on Roseanne saw him and was like, this guy's tearing it up at Yuck Yucks. And, like, there's not that many that are from that club scene up here, especially since Yuck Yucks has now shrunk to, like, I think one or two locations. But it was the big comedy chain. Kitchener had a Yuck Yucks. Obviously, there's one in Ottawa, Montreal, Toronto. There were, like,
one in Brampton, I think.
Yeah, like you here in the States, like the Laugh Factory, the Improv, and all, we don't really have a ton of those, right?
Mm-hmm.
But if you saw that a Yuck Yucks was on, you'd have some local talent. There usually was a few up and comers, and you might have a headliner, but anybody bigger would go to, like, a big stage. Well, he's one of those guys that came up from that, you know, ground up thing here, and then made it big in the States. Very few do, like Jim Carrey and all these guys. They all had to move to the States before they got famous.
Mm-hmm. So I guess in conclusion, Norm MacDonald, we're going to miss you. Turd Ferguson, Burt Reynolds, all your other impressions.
Yes, I love that he could do a couple impressions really well. Bob Dole was one of the ones people remember. But the vast and his Letterman kills me, because his Letterman wasn't so much about him being like a perfect impression of Letterman. It was making fun of how boring Letterman's shows could be.
Oh yeah,
like how Letterman would take a joke that didn't work and keep trying it over and over and over again.
And
he would just play it to death, and it was that's what made it more funny to me in the first place. I was looking here; you can rent a digital copy of Dirty Work on YouTube.
So, folks, if you want to have a good laugh with Norm Macdonald one last time. You can take a look at that. I think Mike Tyson Mysteries is still on Netflix.
That, yeah, and that's probably where I think the younger, like any of the younger millennials or Gen Z, that's where you know him from, is he's Pigeon, and he will forever be immortalized as the sex-crazed Pigeon.
So rest in peace, Norm. Good night, sweet prince. Moving on to our next story, which will hopefully be a little bit lighter in terms. Once again, continuing from the website Deadline, Hayley Atwell to voice Lara Croft in Netflix's Tomb Raider anime series. You may remember her as Peggy Carter and most recently as Captain Carter from Marvel's What If series. But I'm going to read from the story directly now.
Okay, sorry. My brain doesn't work the same way. I didn't recognize that she was. I thought she was the girl from Little Miss Sunshine.
I don't know, actually.
But that's a completely different person. I'm 99% sure.
So Hayley Atwell, who's part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe as Agent Peggy Carter, who is next up in Mission Impossible 7, has been cast as the voice of Lara Croft in Netflix and Legendary's Tomb Raider anime series. It is based upon the Square Enix action-adventure video game that has spawned comic books, 3 feature films, and a 4th one that is on the way. The anime series, first announced in January, will pick up after the video game reboot trilogy and follow the heroine 25 years after her first video game appeared as she explores new territory. Tomb Raider will be written by Tasha Hugh, The Witcher Blood Origin, and Red Sonja, who is executive producing with DJ2 Entertainment founder and CEO Dimitri M. Johnson, who also did Sonic the Hedgehog, and Steven Buga, or Buja, I think. Howard Bliss, Jacob Robinson will also be an executive producer via his company Tractor Pants. On the big screen, Lara Croft is an archaeologist, treasure hunter, and thrill seeker who was played by Angelina Jolie in 2 films in 2001 and 2003, which we reviewed earlier this summer, by the way. The franchise was revived in 2018 with Alicia Vikander in the lead role. A sequel to that pick is in the works with Lovecraft Counties.
I really liked that movie.
Yeah.
And I don't know how well it was received by the fandom, because I'll fully admit, I own the trilogy. 2 of them came with my Xbox is when I purchased them over the years. I've never actually played them, and I never played the originals either.
The reboot trilogy is fantastic. I first played it on the PlayStation 3, then it got remastered on PlayStation 4 and Xbox One. Then there was Shadow of the Tomb Raider, I think is the latest one.
That's Rise of the Tomb Raider by Eidos Montreal, I think, right?
Yes. Rise of the Tomb Raider is probably my favorite, which takes place in the mountains of, I want to say, the
one, right?
Yeah, the second one. And the combat's really fun. The story's really interesting. It's just a fantastic video game.
So you're saying I should, since I already own them, I was waiting for like next gen patches, but should I go back and play them on the Xbox then before the show comes out?
Absolutely. Just because, like, especially the reboot trilogy, it gives a lot of quality of life upgrades. And when you start getting weapons that make sense, like you find a shotgun, then you can rebuild parts to it. You get better parts for your bow and everything.
Yeah.
And the storyline, like I said, in the first one, you're fighting a god who's being resurrected. And then you find out your father had some weird dealings, if I remember this right.
So it's basically like
Indiana Jones.
Uncharted, but Lara Croft.
Yeah, and it's a lot of fun. It was probably one of my favorite games of the PlayStation 3, and definitely the next generation as well.
Like, I didn't play the originals, and to me, like, my extent of knowledge of Lara Croft in the 90s was like the EGM magazine where she was topless and they covered her with like screenshots.
Yeah.
And then it was like, find the nude code. That didn't exist.
I remember there was a Playboy magazine that came out, I want to say about 1998, I want to say.
Yeah.
And they got the video game model, or the person who they based her on, and they got her to pose nude and everything. And I thought that was weird that the company who owns the copyright would allow that. And that's the first time I can ever think of cosplay crossing into the mainstream.
Well, and then there was, what was it, Final Fantasy Spirits Within was the first time they just did a digital nude model.
Yeah.
And it was and that was not so much like, oh god, here's nudity for the, it was more like, look what we can do with the anime. And I mean, that's a 20-year-old movie, right? But like, they were like, look at how good our polygons are. And now they wouldn't even think of doing that because it's like, so what? But that was a big deal at the time. And I remember that was all over the news. Even they're like the nude codes and all this, like all these rumors back in the days before the internet was big.
Yep. I mean, it's interesting how much of a cultural icon Lara Croft has become. And I think it's cool. Like, I would love to see a crossover video game where you can have Nathan Drake and Laura Croft work together. I think that would be awesome.
Dude, when I was in like grade 4 or grade 5, and all the talk was like, how long do you think it's going to be till we get a Duke Nukem crossover with her? Because she's basically female Duke Nukem. But this is like 9, 10-year-olds, right?
Yeah.
That we were like, man, Duke Nukem and this, or like when you're like 9 years old, because remember, I'm a little younger than you, right?
Yeah.
But I'm like 9 years old. That game is out and it's like the biggest thing. And people were like, did you hear? Yeah, they're going to do a crossover because she's really his girlfriend.
Actually, I just had a thought, and I don't know if it's possible. Could Laura Croft appear in Smash Brothers? Has she been on a Nintendo console? Maybe back in the GameCube days, maybe?
I don't think she was there for that. I think, if anything, it would have been Game Boy games.
I don't know. So if you people know, feedback at ThisWeekInGeek.net, I'd be curious to know. Moving on to our next story. This one comes courtesy of Gizmodo, and this is interesting. She-Ra makes the leap to Amazon for a live-action TV show. It feels like only yesterday that we said goodbye to She-Ra and the Princess of Power, Netflix and DreamWorks' excellent animated reboot of the iconic heroine and her friends. And while Prince Adam is off on an adventure on classic and new on the streamer, Adora and Etheria are taking a leap into a whole new realm and a whole other streamer. Variety reports that Amazon Studios has partnered with DreamWorks Animation to develop a new live-action She-Ra series for Prime Video. The new show, which is currently in the very earliest stages of development, and has no creative crew or cast attached yet, will not be a continuation of the story told in either She-Ra's classic Masters of the Universe spinoff in the 80s or the rebooted tale told in She-Ra and the Princesses of Power. Instead, it will be an entirely new imagining of the character with no connections to previous series. It's a surprising move not just to see She-Ra make the leap into live action. Amazon is certainly trying to tie itself in fantastical swords and sorcery adventures right now between its Lord of the Rings prequel series and the Wheel of Time adaptation. But Mattel's big plans for the rest of the Masters universe right now are tied up over at Netflix. She-Ra's previous home for Princesses of Power. There you'll find the ongoing Kevin Smith-fronted continuation of the original He-Man cartoon with the gritty Masters of the Universe revelations, which we reviewed earlier this summer, as well as an all-new spin aimed at younger audiences in the form of 3DCC He-Man and the Masters of the Universe set to debut on September 15th. Enticing Alora from that circle and to bring her into a new platform, but also an entirely new medium for the character, could be very interesting indeed. I think if you could make this like a more modern Xena, but have still the fantastic ideas of that Masters of the Universe kind of aesthetic, this
how
could
young
be
do you
want to
cast
awesome.
It?
I would make her 18 to 24.
Okay.
And I would focus on that, because the cool thing about He-Man is it's kind of like Conan, but with super technology, because Man-at-Arms has fucking lasers and Roboto is a completely cybernetic character.
I would cast her as an adult. When I say adult, I mean 30s.
Okay.
And you know who I'd cast?
Who?
Charlotte from the WWE.
I could see that.
I mean, it depends. Do you want like the blonde heroine Valkyrie looking kind of thing, or do you go with a different like hair color and look? The reason I'm saying Charlotte or somebody from the world of wrestling is they can do their own stunts, and yes, they're muscular, and they'll know how to carry themselves, and they're accustomed to doing melodramatic crazy lines.
You just need someone who has that right charisma to pull that off. I think Charlotte Flair, I think, might not be the...
She has the look.
She has the look, but I don't think she has the charisma to carry it. However, though, I like your line of thinking. So maybe look in NXT, maybe AEW's got somebody, maybe even TNA for all I know. There's a lot of possibilities for here, especially because it's She-Ra. I love Skeletor from He-Man. That is not without question. But Hordak, I thought, was a more interesting design.
You know who you could do for Evil-Lyn?
Who?
That is where you go with, oh, I know her face, but I'm drawing a blank. WWF wrestler, what, Toronto. From Toronto. Biggest wrestler of all time, female. Trish Stratus.
Oh, yeah? I can
Trish
see
Stratus,
that.
She's got the eyes. Put her in there. She can do the over-the-topness. You just picture her being like, ah, ha, ha, ha.
I want to crossover with He-Man, but you save that until the season one finale.
Oh, I'm stupid. I mean, okay. I guess you can't cast because of Marvel contracts, but what about Black Widow's sister?
Oh, the girl that plays Yelena. Yeah, that's a really good pick.
She's got the right body type. She's not so thin that it doesn't look like she's like a Amazon warrior, right?
Yeah.
She's got like the physicality. She's got the look. I don't know. It depends on how tall they want to cast somebody, but she could do it. Or I'm trying to think somebody else. There's got to be other actresses, but it's a role that you're going to need to have a certain amount of physicality to do.
Yeah.
To make it realistic. Otherwise, it's a CGI fest, and then it looks like crap.
Yeah, like I want this to be successful. I loved She-Ra as a kid, and mostly because of Hordak and the Horde Troopers. I love the look of the Horde Troopers. They're just the generic stormtroopers for Hordak and the Thing of Evil, and I just thought it looked cool. Plus, I think She-Ra had better looking bad guys at times, and I think that'd be neat. So I'm really looking forward to this. I hope Amazon does it right and they're not wrong, where they're putting money into Wheel of Time, Lord of the Rings. Amazon has really stepped up its game in terms of its streaming options,
even their animation. Like, I can't wait for Invincible season 2.
Yeah, like there's so much good stuff going on, reviving some of these 80s properties. Like, one thing I'd love to see them do, and I think they could pull it off depending on how you adapted it, I think there's a reboot coming of Silverhawks at some point, which was a very strange animated show where people could fly in space, but they had this metallic armor.
That was the follow-up to the, not related, but the same team that made Thundercats, right?
I think in the same vein, yeah.
And then there was another one they made that was like a miniseries that didn't do well. But yeah, like there was, you know, they sort of animalized powers.
If Visionaries would be another one that I'd like to see come back. Mask, I'd love to see. I think Hasbro's supposed to do something with
Mask and ROM are in the works for a crossover with G.I. Joe.
Yeah, ROM the Space Knight is something nobody talks about, but I would love to see. And I can't remember
Micronauts is in the works as well?
I think so. So there's a lot to get excited about, especially if you're in our age range. Like, I'm 40 in like a month. Alex is, you're what, 34?
I'll be 35 in February. So I am exiting the youngest demo that people actually want, and I'll be entering the 35 to 59 category, which means I'm just an adult.
So that'll be a really good time. And then our final story this week, this one comes courtesy of Bloody Disgusting, and I actually kind of talked about this on the B-side with Skyblaze earlier this week, and it was talking about Elvira. So Elvira makes her horror host return with Shudder's Elvira's 40th anniversary. Very, very scary, very special. Shudder proves it's not messing around with their 61 days of Halloween lineup by bringing back the horror queen of camp, Elvira. This year marks the 40th anniversary for the horror host, icon, and mistress of the dark. And the AMC Network's premium streamer is celebrating with a one-night movie marathon event, Elvira's 40th anniversary. Very scary, very special. Then you can watch a teaser here. The special debuts on Saturday, September 25th, so next week, in the U.S. and Canada via Shudder TV feed within the Shudder app.
And but we'll also, did you hear that key point there? And Canada.
Yes, so that's pretty impressive. So whatever movie they're streaming has rights in both territories.
Because unlike Joe Bob Briggs, where we had to wait how long till we got it? Like a year? Year and a half? It looks like we're finally getting at least North America-wide simul releases, probably since they've really stepped up their game on original programming.
Mm-hmm. So the article continues, but this will also be released on demand to all Shudder platforms in US, Canada, UK, Ireland, Australia, and New Zealand, and AMC Plus.
Do you think maybe, like, they haven't announced what movie she's going to be hosting for it?
Actually, they have.
Have they?
Yeah. So the article continues, similar to the cult classic late night television series Elvira's movie Macabre, which debuted in 1981, Elvira will lend her own blend of witty commentary to a horror movie lineup that includes Elvira, Mistress of the Dark, which was her first movie.
That's what I was going to say. I figured they would start with that one.
House on Haunted Hill.
Basically lampooning her own movie.
House on Haunted Hill, which I don't know which version they're going with. City of the Dead. If that's the Italian horror movie, that's going to be awesome. Maybe.
House on Haunted Hill will probably be the Vincent Price version.
Wait, I am looking at the dates. They are here in the article. Okay. Sorry, folks. So she goes on to say, it's always tough turning 40, but what better way to mark the occasion than a one-night stand with Shudder, the spookiest of streamers. It's going to be the ultimate Halloween anniversary bash, and you don't want to miss it, Elvira said in a statement. Shudder GM Craig Engler added, Elvira is a legend who's been lighting up our screens and delighting fans for over 40 years, and we're honored to celebrate the Queen of Halloween's fantastic career milestone with her very special, the perfect treat for Shudder members this holiday season. What can fans expect from the Halloween Bash? The lineup of the movie marathon includes Elvira, Mistress of the Dark, which was released in 1988. Upon arriving in a small town where she has inherited a rundown mansion, the famous horror hostess battles an evil uncle and townspeople who want her burned at the stake. House on Haunted Hill from 1959. William Castle's gimmick-laden horror thriller is a fairground funhouse come to life. Vincent Price stars as a suave, eccentric millionaire married to a beautiful and greedy gold digger. Together, they're hosting a party in a sinister haunted house.
Really good movie.
Yeah, I've seen that one once.
If you're watching it now, you'll be like, that was scary. That was one of the ones where they had like a skeleton go towards the screen in 3D, right?
Yeah.
But when it would happen, when it first did its initial launch in major areas like Toronto, New York, and that, the theater would be rigged up with an actual skeleton that would fall from the sky and run up the aisles next to you as a kid. So the skeleton would come towards the screen, and then the real skeleton would drop from the ceiling and scream as it went past the audience. When they used to do those crazy immersive experiences back then. Mm-hmm. So like it's the kind of movie where if you talk to your parents or grandparents, they're like, I was terrified because they had real props in the theater.
The next movie is called The City of the Dead, which isn't the one I was hoping it would be, but this one's from 1960. In this atmospheric classic, professor and horror icon Christopher Lee sends a student to Whitewood, Massachusetts, the site of the 17th century witch burnings. Once there, she learns the satanic secrets that live on. And then finally, Messiah of Evil, released in 1973. A young woman goes searching for her missing artist father. Her journey takes her to a strange Californian seaside town governed by a mysterious undead cult. William Hurick and Gloria Katz's hypnotic, unsettling independent horror is a must-see gem. Then there's a trailer if you want to see it there. I think that's fantastic. I was really hoping Elvira would take advantage of Shudder. And Cassandra Peterson, she still does conventions. She very much loves her fans. She did In Search of Darkness 1 and 2.
She has the energy awesome. Still. Like, she's 69.
She looks gorgeous, still.
Awesome. but the reality is, like, she is still a very, very confident, impassioned person. She's still beautiful. And she goes off and she'll, like, there. I remember seeing people come at her saying, you know, like, look at what she had to do. She had to dress like this. And she went off on some of the feminists online that she's like, no. I'm a real feminist. I did what I wanted to do. Don't put words in my mouth and don't try to claim I'm something I'm not. I like doing this. And it was like, oh, she shut people down.
Yeah.
She is a very independent and strong person.
Yeah. She's proud of where she came from, and it's very clear that she cares about the genre and wants more people to have fun with it. And we think of the horror hosts like Svengoolie, Vampira, and there's been many others.
Like, Svengoolie is still going strong. He's the only one that's like consistent. But from like my childhood, I remember her being on, and she would pop up after her show ended. They would be like, you remember, was it A&E or TBS had dinner and a movie, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
And occasionally when it was Halloween, they would have her. She would pop up on other people's versions of that kind of a hosting show.
Yeah.
And she would show up at like City TV when they would do like great movies for Halloween and stuff. So she would pop up on different national broadcasters in the States and Canada, even when her show was over, as that character, as if it had never ended.
So I want to say she was in the Super Mario Brothers Super Show at one point.
Probably. She was that weird category where she was like almost like a hypersexualized character that appeared in kid stuff and adult stuff because she was never risque. She had a big bust and she was like, you know, over the top sexified in her appearance, but she never behaved like lewd.
Yeah, she was just, I look sexy, I'm cool, here's a cool horror movie, let's talk about it.
And by like, the way, I'm a lot smarter than you think I am.
Yeah, like, I would love to see a collaboration between her, Sven Gulli, and Mystery Science Theater 3000.
And you know what? Pull him out. I know he's retired. Get, because just because for fun, get Count Floyd back from SCTV, right? Because the whole idea there with the Count Floyd character was to make fun of those old hosts in the 70s, right? And he would, you know, dress up as Dracula. Get whoever is around from that time period to do something together. And she'll probably do something with Joe Bob Briggs and anybody else. No, get her to do something with the Crypt Keeper.
Yeah, John Cazar would be really good, especially if they have, like, they must have Crypt Keeper puppets still hanging around.
They're rebooting the show. So, and it's been in the works for a while for HBO Max, I believe, right? Mm-hmm. So while she's doing stuff for Shudder, remember, she's not owned by Shudder. She's not restricted to only one network.
I think she owns her own copyright.
She owns her character. That's her. So that's why she's been able to jump. That's why she was able to jump from channel to channel and appear in Canada. Like, she didn't have to get permission from anybody.
Yeah, I mean, I'm glad she's coming back. I'm going to make it a point to watch this with my next door neighbor, Liam. I think it's going to be a fun time. So look forward to that. That's on September 25th. Shudder is super cheap, totally worth it. You should check that out.
Free trial, I think, for a week or a month or something anyway.
Yeah, I think so. So anyway, guys, we're going to take a break here on ThisWeekInGeek.net, and we're going to go to the final frontier as we check out the Star Trek 4 movie collection on 4K from Paramount Home Entertainment. We will be back right after this.
Space, the final frontier. These are the continuing voyages of the starship Enterprise. Her ongoing mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life forms and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
Taking a look at the Star Trek, the original 4 movie collection coming to us from Paramount Home Entertainment. I am Lieutenant Commander Birdman, joined by Admiral Ricci, and we're going to talk about this. Now, of course, you've seen these movies. They've been out for decades now at this point, but this is the first time the first four have ever been presented in 4K. Alex took the first two of these movies. I took 3 and 4 because I've got more of a connection to these. And we're both going to have different kind of perspectives on this. However,
So what you're saying is Alex will take the cold and calculating first movie because that he's a cold and calculating individual. And then Wrath of Khan because he owns every version of it available.
Yeah, pretty much. Whereas I'm into the more, I would say, eccentric Star Treks and the more fun ones where you say, dumbass on you.
You're quirky Trek.
Yeah, exactly. So, all right, let's go through the first two movies, Alex. What are they like in 4K?
I can say this. They aren't just an upscale. If anybody was worried that, or even like an 8, there's some fancy-dancy AI upscaling now that can be done to some releases. These are brand new scans. So they've gone back to the original, these films have been remastered a few times. If there's one franchise that CBS Paramount, you know, have as their golden goose when it comes to like the pinnacle of restorations and preservation, it's Star Trek. You know, going all the way back to the HD DVD and Blu-ray releases of the original series being fairly early on in the life cycle of high definition home entertainment. So what they've done here is a brand new scan, cleaned it up even more than previously, and big plus is they've done tone mapping. And if you're somebody listening who doesn't know what that is where a cinematographer or somebody involved in high grade cinema coloring goes through each frame and every scene and adjusts the color and as well as the brightness and tinting and everything to match what the original vision was by the director for when it was watched in theaters. So that's what is a critical component for HDR, you know, high dynamic range. So if you have a 4K TV with it, you know, it's HDR compatible or Dolby Vision and so on, you're going to get the color and saturation and brightness and everything that you would get if you went and saw this at like a Dolby Cinema.
Oh, wow.
So it, you're almost indistinguishable from what you would see at a cinematic release, other than having, you know, the giant 100-foot screen or something, right? And we all know the audio for these movies have always been, you know, 5.1 or 7.1, that they've always been really good at restoring them. So it's you are getting a transferred audio track from the previous Blu-rays, but you can't really make a 40-year-old movie sound better than already does when they've done what they did to it like 10 years ago, right?
I think they're like 7.1 mixes,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah, which is the same as they've been in previous releases. Mm-hmm. So you can't really, like, you know what I mean? They can't add more sound that's not there. But what you can do is take an optical image and blow it up bigger. So that's what they've done, is they've captured it at the most detail they've ever done. I would say the most improved visually would be Star Trek The Motion Picture, because that had some crazy visual effects. If you remember, it was very 2001 Space Odyssey-like in its presentation. So that has the most dramatic improvement in just color depth and quality. Wrath of Khan Director's Cut is marginally better, but it's still nice to see it look that good.
Looking at 3 and 4, it's been at least 10-15 years since I've seen these movies. So seeing them again in 4K was like seeing them for the first time. Like the colors in 3 and 4, because there's a lot of reds and deep blues and greens. Very, very vivid. There's a lot of model work, because this is the movie where they did extensive models for the Klingon Bird of Prey that it's space dock. There's a really interesting featurette on how they made space dock with plexiglass and I think EL wire, so it's practical, and it's really, really, really neat. Now, the movie themselves look fantastic. I think 4 maybe suffers the most. It still looks fantastic, but because of the movie was shot in the 1980s, some things look a little out of place, but that's just to be expected with such a kind of upscale from things. However, though, seeing some of the detail on the Enterprise when they come back into space dock, when you get the Enterprise A, which has been restored after they save the whales, you can see texture on the top of the saucer section I don't think you could see in previous releases, and they are fantastic. So one of the things I do want to talk about here is some of the special features here. They seem to be a lot of holdovers from previous releases, though not everything that has ever been released. Because one thing I thought that looked really nice, but I had to check the copyright on it several times and actually fact check with some Star Trek experts, there are these Starfleet Academy science briefs, and there are, because I watched 3 and 4, there are two of them. One of them talks about the Katra experience, and it has a woman science officer at Starfleet Academy dressed in a Nemesis-era uniform that's partially a dress uniform that doesn't make any sense. So that was a little strange, and I was wondering, oh, did they shoot that for this movie? And no, that turns out that's from a 2009 special feature, or at least that's what the copyright date was.
You did the phone a friend, didn't you, to be like, I need somebody who's even geekier than me to point this out.
Yeah, I was like, I need to know what era is this from, because it's not TNG and it's not the Picard era uniforms, because that's what I thought they were going to do for this 4K release. We might get something really special. We're like, hey, we just paid an actor to sit in like a place for a day. We spent like $1,000. Let's have some fun.
Well, we're in a weird sort of situation with these discs too, because, you know, we're talking about the 4K discs, right? The 4K discs are standard. Here's the movie in the highest quality. It's the Blu-rays that are accompanying in this package that have the special features. The special features appear in most part to be transferred, like you said, from previous releases that, you know, spanned from 2009 to 2013 or so.
Actually, yes. The earliest one I found was 2002.
Some of the features, yes, but not
yes,
the,
some of the
features,
actual, yes.
But I'm saying from the Blu-ray discs.
Yeah, like right. Overall, you are getting a very in-depth package, especially
but I should
commentaries.
Say this, the movies, though, on those Blu-ray discs are from the new 4K masters.
Yes, yes.
So I did compare them side by side, and if you look at the discs, how you can tell, because Paramount discs are, when they're Blu-rays, they're all these, they're just blue tops. They have, you know, nothing special on each of them, but the copyright date is updated to 2021 on all four of the Blu-rays. And if you look, I have all the previous ones from multiple collections previously. They are different. They also, if you pop the discs into a computer to play them on, you know, a Blu-ray player on your computer, the disc sizes are different from the. So these are clearly new transfers. They just did bring over the features that have been recorded anywhere in the last 20 years.
Absolutely. So I would say Star Trek, the original 4 movie collection on 4K from Paramount Home Entertainment. I think it's worth picking these up because if we want the rest of the movies in 4K, we're going to have to say we're willing to buy it with our wallets. And that's really, the fans are going to have to speak here. And I would imagine the next collection will probably be 5, 6, and maybe Generations, because that's the that would be the end of the original series storyline, technically.
So. Yeah, and I would say it's worth it as well, considering that this is sort of what we had to do with TNG when it was coming out on Blu-ray, right? And nobody was sure if they were going to release all 7 seasons, and then everybody kept buying the seasons. So that's how we got it. And then we eventually got the big box set that had everything.
Yeah, so if you want to check this out, folks, I highly recommend you do. These are wonderful movies that speak to generations of Star Trek fans, and I think the special features, especially commentaries, are worth checking out, especially the especially rare Leonard Nimoy commentary. So once again, Star Trek, the original 4 movie collection, gets a, well, set 2 to beam up from us here at This Week in Geek.
The needs of the many outweigh
the needs of the few.
Or the one.
Go crazy.
Don't mind if I do.
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria.
All right, so we have returned from space dock, and we are ready to head back out into the strange, the unusual, the bizarre things that have happened around the planet this past week right here on ThisWeekInGeek.net. Our first story comes from BoingBoing.net, and the Minnesota State Fair's butter sculptor retires after a 50-year run. Sculptor Linda Christensen, 79, have spent half a century carving faces into large lumps of butter. The sculptures, which are created in front of an audience of fairgoers, are modeled after winners of the Princess K of the Milky Way pageant. Each butter bust can take 6 hours to finish, and some pageant winners keep butter likenesses for decades. Other winners melt the sculptures down and use the butter for cooking. One even held a community pancake breakfast. Now, after churning out more than 500 princess butter heads over nearly 5 decades, Cruis'n has decided to retire her knife. She turned her 90-pound block into a creamy masterpiece at the fairgrounds last month from her glass-enclosed studio. She's turning over the knife to Jerry Coulter, an art teacher from Litchfield, Minnesota, who was chosen as her successor. You know what? One thing I've always wanted to do, and I think that's maybe the inner Canadian in me, or maybe it's just from watching things through American television and the Food Network. I've always wanted to go to an American state fair. Some of them look really, really fun.
Well, especially nothing against our East Coast and our West Coast people, or even our Southern people. There's something about the Midwest. It's like people always think like there's nothing going on in these certain states, right? Because you only hear about the East Coast and West Coast when it comes to entertainment and stuff. But it's like, no, it's always like Indiana and Wisconsin, all those places that have the craziest, like awesome state fairs, because they just have these traditions going back like over 100 years. I have been to, like, in Ontario, we don't have like
we have fall fairs.
We don't have an official like province fair. The closest would be
maybe the CNE or the X.
Yes, well, the Canadian National Exhibition, and that's even though it's in Toronto, and it's a provincial one, it is basically a federal fair. Like it's a nationwide fair,
and people come from all over for it.
And it is bigger than pretty much any state fair. Mm-hmm. Like the closest in size would be maybe like the Kentucky Derby.
I don't know, because there's a friend of mine on Facebook.
And the Calgary Stampede.
Yes, which I've been to that, and that one's intense. I'm surprised just how big it is.
And that's like, I would say CNE, for summertime / warm weather, it's the CNE and the Stampede in Calgary. And in winter, Toronto has the Winter Fair, And then doesn't Quebec have like the Winterloo or something?
Something like that. And so I know there's something in Ottawa too.
And that's more of a, like, if you want to talk about a provincial fair or state fair, the winter one in Toronto would be considered that.
There was one in Edmonton that I went to called Klondike Days, which was a lot of fun. There's a friend of mine on Facebook, and she's going to one, and I didn't know this, because her state doesn't have an official state fair. And I think because she's literally in the middle of six different states, I think it's called the Big Six. And it's like six states all celebrating at once in one location. Or something like that. It sounds really, really, really fun. But yeah, like there's always something about the atmosphere of the fair. You get these fantastic foods. I know there's a show on the Food Network called, I can't remember the name of the show. I can see the host's face. But if you go on thefoodnetwork.com or .ca and type in fall fair, you'll find out exactly what I'm talking about. And you get all these experimental foods, which are nine times out of ten terrible for you.
Was it Carnival Eats?
That's it. And that just looks fun. But also, you get a surprising amount of smaller bands, but bands that still like the tour and do smaller venues like a state fair or a carnival. And they'll draw a pretty decent crowd. Sure, they may only be playing for maybe 500, maybe 1,000 people. But I kind of like that charm. And there's something about fairs that I like, because one of the fairs that I've been to with my wife, there's the Dundalk Fall Fair, and there's like a photography contest, which I think I won one year when I was in college. There is a demolition derby. There's a pumpkin carving contest. There's like best pig, or there's like always like some awards for like, here's the best cow or whatever, or here's a chicken or something. And I don't know, there's something, I know I come from a rural area and I tend to reject my rural roots, but there's something very comforting about going to cultural events like this. I don't know, there's just something. Yeah. I think I romanticize it maybe a little too much, but like it though.
Well, there's a lot. And you know what I was thinking, as we don't really call things, like you said, state fairs or provincial fairs. So I looked it up. There's a bunch from each province, but I'll just go with Ontario because that's where we know, right? Winterlude is the one in Ottawa. That's the yeah. I thought that was Quebec's, but I was wrong. But I forgot we have like somewhat regional ones. Like we have municipal ones for the regions, and then there's some that just end up exploding bigger. Like you could think of the Stratford Shakespeare Festival as a big thing. It's sort of like, that's all plays and Ren Fair type stuff.
The Western Fall Fair in London is huge.
Yeah, that's one of them right there. And then if you think of probably one of the oldest and biggest ones would be Oktoberfest here.
Yep, that's true. And that's next month.
Yeah, it comes usually right before and right after our Thanksgiving. Yep. And I don't know what it's going to be like this year. I think it's allowing in person for certain. I think the beer tents are going to be open this year. But it's one of those cases where we usually had anywhere from up to 1 million people would show up, and people would fly. Like, it's the second biggest Oktoberfest in the world in this region. Like, obviously, in Germany, you go to Munich and you go to Berlin, and they have bigger ones. But, like, there's nothing in the States as big as this. There's Frankenmuth and a couple places that do it. And when you go down to those little towns down there, they're like, look at Oktoberfest. This is so big. And it's like, yeah, the biggest Oktoberfest in America is, like, 10% the size of the one here. So we've got that, but that's sort of more of a cultural, like we have cultural festivals that are not so much like based on like, here's like the German fest. Here's like, there's like even a Muslim fest in the Toronto area. We have a lot of like rib fests, right?
The Caribbean Festival in Toronto.
Yeah.
That's another big one.
Well, and the other big one that we have,
on the Danforth is another big
one.
Yeah.
Taste of the Danforth. And that's traditionally, I think, like Greek and other European, like where you taste all the different foods. The other big one for this area, other than Oktoberfest, is we didn't have it this year really, is the Kitchener Blues Fest.
Yes.
And people come up from all over, like musicians come from the States, but like we're talking, like we had like Buddy Guy, and we were supposed to have BB King at one point. Like it's another one where there's several hundred thousand people that show up, and it's a free festival where they close down the entire downtown and there's concerts all day from world-renowned musicians that are, you know, platinum recording artists.
See, that's the one festival I really wanted to go to, because I've talked about this a few times on the podcast, but probably it slips through the cracks, or Mike listens to nerd music and that's about it. I really enjoy jazz. I love the sound of a good brass ensemble.
Speaking of, so Kitchener has the Blues Fest, which is, you know, several hundred thousand people show up for that. Waterloo, which is connected, does the Jazz Festival, which as far as that is concerned, it's a smaller festival overall, but they would again pull people from all over the world. So there's a jazz one there, there's that, then there's usually some sort of other concert, or I think they do like a busker fair where there's like street performers are not usually allowed in the region, but it's like one festival, like one long weekend a year where they would have them, and they would close down the entire city streets, and it's just busker after busker after busker. So like there's those sorts of things here. And then the smaller towns always have like agricultural festivals, right? Mm-hmm. You'll have like the beaver tail ones and the maple syrup ones and yada yada yada. But like I think probably the biggest one in Canada is probably the CNE.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But that's become more of a like showcase for new cars and products than it is anything else.
So obviously this woman, enjoy your retirement, may your successor carve in butter and not margarine. So moving on to yet another story from boingboing.net, the Major League Baseball is testing out the robot umpires to optimize baseball. Major League Baseball has been developing a automated ball strike system that trains computers to determine whether or not a pitch arrives over home plate within a designated ideal strike zone. The Atlantic League of Professional Baseball, one of the premier minor league farm leagues of the MLB, has been testing out this technology at real life ball games. Most players refer to it as the robo umpire. Major League Baseball has designed the system and was testing in the Atlantic League, where Fred DeJesus, I don't know how to pronounce it.
DeJuice?
The term robo umpire conjures a little R2-D2 position behind the plate, beeping for strikes and booping for balls. But for the aesthetic and practical reasons, MLB wanted a human umpire to announce the calls, as if placating their former roles. So this person had his calls fed to him through an earpiece connected to a modified missile tracking system. The contraption looked like a large black pizza box with one glowing green eye. It was mounted above the press box. When the first pitch came in, a recorded voice told him it was a strike. He announced it, and no one in the ballpark said anything. When the robots came, the arguments basically stopped. After the Ducks game, I met with DeJuice outside the ballpark, and there were six calls that I disagreed with, he said, referring to the words that came through the earpiece from the robot. One pitch was right down the middle, and I went to call strike three, and it said ball, and it went ball, and I looked at the dugout, and no one had come out to argue. He continued, I missed the battles. My first job was umpiring. I was about 12 years old, one of the dozens of kids my age trained under the tutelage of Artie Mann, who was supposedly a big deal, or so we were told. Whatever his accolades, he was a baseball drill sergeant. Where's your strike zone? He'd growl, and we'd all shout back in unison in the words that he had taught us. From the nose to the toes, nobody walks but the mailman. The other umpting idiom that still resonates in my mind was Arnie's steadfast rejection of the tie goes to the runner. The rules of baseball are clear. He'd say the runner has to beat the ball to the bag. If the runner ties, that means they didn't beat the ball, and that means you're out of here. Despite being young, I don't remember being heckled by too many parents. It was still Little League after all. We were paid a flat rate per game, which incentivized us to get out there as fast as possible. But my dad still likes to remind me of one particular ump. He'd come out to watch me sometimes, which was next to impossible for me to determine whether the runner actually beat the ball to the bag. The players' parents all waited with bated breath for me to make the call. Instead, I did what Arnie Mann taught us to do, consult with the other umpire. As I learned that day, there are a few things that infuriate grown men more than the acknowledgement of uncertainty. Following a good faith attempt at resolution, clearly I was not long for the umpiring life, and unlike Mr. DeJuice, I do not miss the battles. But I was worried about the disappointments of those angry men who rely on heckling Little League players and umps to relive their past glories. Perhaps they'll yield to their robot overlords as they unquestionably assert their strike zones improved by the machine's unwavering confidence. Will they have to find a new outlet for their anger? Will they allow their own baseball folk idioms to change in order to fit the determinations of a supposedly more precise robot umpire? Or will the junk in the trunk theory of the algorithm destroy the game forever? And more importantly, how long until we replace the pitchers with those AI equipped batting cage pitch machines? I think computer assisted baseball is okay. Like, if you're helping determine exactly what happens, if it should be a consult, two humans and the machine, the human ultimately holds the final call.
Well, if it's there to help with integrity, like it can kind of help if, you know, an umpire, somebody
who is a little sketchy.
Yeah, he might have suspected his bought off or might be owing some gambling debts or something. But I think what people are afraid of, it's like, oh, it's going to replace me. Well, if it can do a better job than you, maybe.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's just, it's one of those things I think that's been a long time coming sort of thing. And I don't know, like I said, I like seeing the accumulation of technology work with sports. I mean, I like it when it improves the game. And I think, once again, having assisting technology helped. As long as it's not making the final call, but if two umpires can look at the same data and arrive at the same conclusion captured by the machine.
What it should be is here's the question. Does the umpire have to be behind there anymore? The umpire should then be behind a screen that, like, where it can track the trajectory of the ball, so that they can make their call, and if it's brought into question, they can go, okay, let's watch the actual video and where it went, and then they can go, similar to the kind of stuff they do for you've seen hockey analysis where, like, they'll use the instant replay and then it uses a computer to track the puck.
Yeah, like, I'm wondering how, if they could maybe have the balls tracked electronically, but anything is obviously subject to human error, and you're never going to take the human element out of sports, or at least not likely. And to kind of take a sidetrack to this article, the artwork that was used for this was the NES game Base Wars.
Oh,
which, my God, why has that not gotten a reboot yet? But yeah, like, I think this
it was Base Wars, and then there was that other game for the was it the Neo Geo? Was it not RBI, it was Baseball
2020 or something like that.
2020 or 20, whatever it was, where you're playing as robots.
That was neat. Yeah, like, I don't know. I think it's really, really, really neat. So hopefully, as things continue to improve with technology and sports, we'll see something neat come out of it. I just don't expect Mutant League football anytime soon. This next story comes courtesy of the Associated Press. Mexico to give away El Chapo safe house in lottery. The house.
Wait, you like to own?
Yeah. So the house, former drug kingpin. I can't pronounce his first name, so I'm just going to call him El Chapo Guzman, fled in 2014 when Mexican Marines had him surrounded, underwent some changes recently as the Mexican government prepared to give it away in a national lottery. The surveillance cameras that covered every angle of the modest home's exterior were removed, and the hole underneath a bathtub that Guzman had slipped through to reach a network of tunnels was covered with a concrete slab. The Associated Press was given access to the property in a quiet Calicun, I think that's how you say it, neighborhood ahead of the lottery. In recent weeks, Mexico's Institute to Return Stolen Goods to the People, known by its initials INDEP, gave it a fresh coat of white paint inside and out and tiled over the spot in the bathroom where the tub and the tunnel entry point had been. The president of I can't pronounce this guy's name. It's too complicated for me. I'm sorry. I think it's the Mexican president.
Is it just
Andreas Manuel Lopez Obrador, I think, has been taking has been talking up the lottery of seized properties, but gave no mention to the history of this particular house, an expansive home in one of Mexico City's swankiest neighborhoods, and a private box at the famed Azteca Stadium all have also garnered more attention. INDP's website lists it as Casa de Calican, and it's a 2,800 square foot and located perhaps appropriately in a neighborhood called Libertad or Freedom. The government values the two-bedroom home at $183,000. The house had been abandoned for years, and the Marines did some damage when they searched it, so repairs were necessary. Guzman escaped that time through the tunnels, but his freedom lasted only days. On February 22, 2014, the Marines descended again, this time into a condo on the coast of Matlin. By that time, Guzman had already had a reputation for daring escapes. He slipped out of one of Mexico's maximum security prisons in 2001, allegedly in a laundry cart. In July 2015, less than a year and a half after his capture in Maitland, Guzman slipped through a tunnel dug up to the drain in his cell shower and rode a motorcycle on tracks laid through a tunnel to escape another medium security Mexican prison. The Marines captured him again 6 months later in Los Mocos, Sinaloa, where he had been holed up with in another unremarkable home. Guzman was extradited to the United States, tried and convicted, and sentenced to life in prison in July 2019. INDP officials, who declined to be identified because they are not authorized to speak, said they were surprised the house was getting attention. It's not luxurious. There's no swimming pool, none of the ostentation that characterizes other narco properties in Sinaloa. People nearby said they didn't know who their neighbor was. We never knew anything. We never knew who lived there. We never saw anyone, said one neighbor, who quickly cut off the conversation. Many locals aren't interested in speaking.
They saw everything. But that, like, saying anything even now is a death sentence. I wouldn't want to live there.
Yeah. I mean, the article just kind of goes on to give a little bit more history. But that's interesting that they would give this property up. I mean,
they can't sell it. Who wants it?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if I'd want to live there just because... reputation alone, for one.
You don't know what they missed inside the walls somewhere. It's hidden, and then somebody from the cartel comes to cut open the wall and kill everybody inside to get like secret documents that they literally built into the wall.
Yeah, like I've read some unpleasant things on various internet forums, and I don't know how much of it is true, but I've also heard people in law enforcement talk about the brutality of the Mexican cartels and everything, and it's dangerous.
As bad as it is, it's still, I would take that house over anything that was previously owned by a Colombian cartel.
Yeah, because those, it's dangerous.
They don't just kill family. They kill all the friends and family of people that were your friends and family.
Yeah, they will come after you. So, I mean, if you get this house, I guess if you get a $5 lottery ticket or whatever it is, good for you. But I don't know if it's worth that $5. So moving on to the next story. This one comes courtesy of Newsweek.com. Woman raids ex-husband's cryogenics lab, steals frozen brains he meant to bring back to life. A Russian woman is being accused by her cryogenics tycoon ex-husband of raiding his cryogenics lab and stealing brains and frozen cadavers of wealthy people hoping to be brought back to life. Daniela Medev, 41, claims the transportation of the bodies was organized by his ex-wife, Valeria Udova, 61, who gathered some staff from her company to assist her. Police intercepted the trucks with the cryogenic patients and Dewar tanks full of liquid nitrogen shortly after the raid at Krios Russ. Some of the corpses stolen belonged to wealthy Americans and Brits, according to the Times. Krios Russ estimates that they had preserved over 80 remains, including brains and full bodies. The company refers to the cadavers as patients, one-third of which are foreigners. It is still unclear whether the transportation of the cadavers and brains damaged any chances of revival, according to Mediev. It seems she doesn't care what happens to their chances of being revived, Mediev told the Times. And experts with Krios Russ says during the heist, nitrogen levels inside the tanks was spilled, which caused the human remains to reach higher than desired temperatures. Cryogenics technology seeks to extend the lifespan and also utilizes frozen liquid nitrogen to preserve dead bodies in hopes of one day being revived. Full body cryopreservation is estimated to cost around $35,000, and the preservation of just the brain costs around $15,000.
By freezing a one-time fee or yearly?
I know there is an upkeep fee because there's a cryogenics lab on the East Coast of the United States that I think it's like I think it's about $20,000 a year to maintain.
But it's, and what's still sad though, mm-hmm. is that we're still in the like prey category where it's like we freeze them, we can't revive them, and we just kind of hope that what we did was the right way to do it in the future when they find out.
Yeah, because one of the big things with cryogenics right now, because I've kind of taken an interest in this, is the problem is when you freeze cells and it freezes the water in them, they form ice crystals. When that happens, the cell's essentially ruined. So they haven't perfected it yet, because if the stuff in your brain, ice crystals, it's going to be a gooey, gooey mess.
You'd have a better chance of with quantum computing in like 100 years, mapping somebody's entire synapses and then copying it to a new body.
Yeah, like there are some...
Because right now, what this sounds like is it's not much different than... What was the Mel Gibson movie? Forever Young?
Yeah.
That was a good movie.
I liked it.
Where he was supposed to be frozen for... I think the test was for 2 years.
And it ended up being like 35 or something.
And then the World War, whatever happened, and the only people that knew about the cryogenics were killed in the war. Mm-hmm. And then he defrosted like 40 years later, 45 years later. And he's like, what?
Now, to kind of wrap this story up, there's a lot of little details in here, but this I found interesting. So CryoRus also cryogenically preserves pet remains for owners hoping to eventually bring them back to life. Currently, CryoRus estimates they have 10 dogs, 19 cats, 4 birds, 2 rabbits, 5 hamsters, and a chinchilla. There are a lot of orders from different countries, especially from dog and cat owners. There's a reason why Mediev wanted to take CryoRus for himself. Wow. That's a terrible
I don't know if I would trust a Russian cryogenics lab.
I guess if they had a really good reputation, but it's the infrastructure that I'd be worried about, because if the power goes out, those generators are only going to last so long, and you need constant liquid nitrogen.
I wouldn't trust anything state run. You'd have to trust somebody who is like a ridiculously rich, like multi-billionaire Russian oligarch.
Or like if Jeff Bezos and Elon Musk teamed up to develop
with some Russian guy who had the same amount of money that, like, because there's dudes in Russia where they don't report their income that's probably at the same level.
Yeah, like there's probably some insane like James Bond villain level of weirdness going on.
Who might like who is playing nice because he has to make sure Putin doesn't come after him, sort of thing.
Yeah. So, yikes! I just can't imagine my body being stolen. But well, anyway,
my argument is you're already dead.
Yeah. I mean, hopefully someday we can reach cryogenics where it's practical, but that's a whole nother ethical discussion.
Well, it also depends on if they're, these are the people where they're like, we froze them after they died. Well, they're already dead. So like, and then if they froze them while they're alive, then you bring up the argument, did you kill them by freezing them?
Mm.
Because if you can't revive them, you just essentially killed them.
Yeah. And they have to put you in such a case. Like this is, I read from another article on cryogenics that happens in North America. If you have a cryogenics order, you need to inform the hospital beforehand because they have so much time to get you prepped for cryogenic preservation. And if it goes over that time,
I don't even think it's legal in Canada.
I don't know. That's something to look into, actually. I'm actually kind
of
curious.
Because I've never heard of a single case. I mean, I've heard of it where they've preserved a brain, but I don't think cryogenics as a last rites sort of thing is even allowed here.
I don't know. It's something. If anybody knows, let us know. So anyway, that's going to do it for this edition of This Week in Geek. And we're going to kind of throw things out to something a little less serious and something a little more bit more fun, throwing back to the arcade times of our youth. This is Alex's review of Cruis'n Blast. We'll be back, guys, right after this.
It's been well over 20 years since we've had a new release in the Cruis'n series of arcade racing games. And our friends over at Rothrill sent a review code for the Nintendo Switch for us to check out. And you know, this was announced at one of the Nintendo Directs. Was it last? Or was it earlier this summer? Or was it even last year? It's all been sort of a blur. Now, this is something that was released in arcades in 2017, but let's be honest, most arcades, at least north of the border here, shut down a long, long time ago, and we have, you know, pockets where there's like a few of the big arcades left, like Palladium, which used to be Sega World back in the 90s, in the GTA area, and then you have occasionally ones at movie theaters. But since the pandemic started, all of the arcades within the movie theaters have been completely shut off, and because it's just too much for them to clean and deal with, and the machines are too cluttered. So you really haven't had a chance to try this game in most cases in Canada at all. So now that it's out on a Nintendo platform, as it should be, we had a chance to check it out. And for a bit of history on it, I think a lot of people played Cruis'n USA on the N64, and especially the arcades, because 1994 is when that initially came out in the arcades, and that was still peak, like, Renaissance era of the arcade, when the 3D racers started taking over, as well as the fighting games of the early 90s, when it had that real Renaissance when I was in grade school. Same with Cruis'n World. I remember playing that at a roller rink in that 1996. Cruis'n Exotica, I never played that. 99. By 1999, it was amazing. Between 96 and 99, a vast, vast majority of arcades had either shrunk or disappeared in Canada and the States. It was getting, you know, more and more hard to find. And then, you know, by 2000, 2001, unless it was at a, you know, at a specific place, like a giant arcade that was like focused on that, or it was at like a movie theater, most of the sit-down cabs were completely gone. You had occasionally arcade cabinets at pizza parlors, but they weren't going to have a sit-down racing arcade cab. So, you know, it's been 22 years, almost 23, since the last Cruis'n game came out. And I'm happy to say that the game plays exactly like you would expect from the Cruis'n games on the N64 era. I was so surprised. It plays buttery smooth. I didn't encounter any slowdowns, which even if it had slowdowns, I might not have minded, because it would have been almost nostalgic for playing it. Because even back in the arcades, you'd have occasional slowdown back in the day, as well as on the N64, obviously. But this played buttery smooth. The color scheme is right in line with an N64. So it is, you know, hyper-saturated, cartoony graphics. You can race as many different types of weird vehicles. The speed seems about right. It's not like it's too fast to handle, but it's also not like a simulation game. Like, you get up to full speed pretty quickly. You can crash through areas of the racing maps that lead to secret areas, paths that will actually get you further ahead than other people that you can just discover by accident sometimes. There's like nearly 30 tracks. There's 29 in the game. There's some fan favorites from the arcade game. There's 23 upgradable vehicles. I've played around with, I think, three of them so far. There's even a unicorn you can play as, which is amazing. And again, feels like a throwback to the 1990s era of like N64 racing games, where they would throw anything in there. Like, you know, some games even had like TIE fighters and stuff randomly. But this is like, in my mind, what I would imagine a high definition version of the 90s arcade racer would be like. It feels like it was ripped right from the arcade, but there's extra modes and plenty of extra gameplay added to it, like, so that it's not like, you know, pop a coin in. It's not like a simulator that way, where it's coin field. It is something that has been adapted for the Switch. And, you know, other than, you know, maybe a few things here or there that I would have done to maybe tweak it slightly, maybe added a little more music or something, it feels like a perfect transplant from the arcade. And if you're looking for something that you can play with your kids, your family, you know, it's a very easy to master racing game. There's not like a bazillion little things you have to customize or do. So this is the pure arcade racing game that I had been hoping for quite some time on the Switch, because the Switch can't really handle high-end simulation, super, you know, fidelity games. What it can do is bring you back to the 1990s with a bit of an HD flare.
Offer expires while you wait. Operators are standing by.
All right, guys. Well, that is the kind of show it has been this week on ThisWeekInGeek.net. This week has been busy, obviously, from meeting people, hanging out with my sister, an emotionally heavy moment for video games. And then I started school this past week full time for the next 3 years. My God, I'm never going to sleep, but that's okay.
Full time is in like 3 or 4 classes or?
No, I'm taking one class a semester, but I am in a full time program. I don't know.
Oh, so basically you're spreading it out over more semesters.
Yeah, like because with me doing the show and the other advocacy work that I do, there's not enough hours in the day. Although I always think of that great line from Men in Black 1 where Tommy Lee Jones looks at Will Smith and says, well, we work on a 36-hour day. You either get used to it or you go insane. And I used to think about that line all the time in college. And I'm thinking, I could do that. I might not sleep well, but I could do that.
We could do that in our 20s. I can still do it if, as long as I'm not moving too much. Like if I'm playing games, I can do 36 hours. But if you're like, hey, Alex, now go to the store, I'd be like, why? My body doesn't want to do that.
Yeah, no. Like I'm old man sleepy time most times. So, yeah, like it's going to be an exciting little while here on the show. There's got a lot of cool stuff that'll be coming out. A brief update for me is it looks like my weight loss surgery things are progressing pretty fast right now. So
now that elective surgeries are back on the table for things.
Yeah. So if the world decides to let things happen, things will be good. And I might be in the OR before the end of the year, but I can still do the show. I only have to have a microphone in front of my face. So I might be off for like a week or two, but I'll be back though. But yeah, it's going to be an exciting time because me and Alex have talked to some of our partners, what's going to be coming up in terms of coverage over the next couple of months. We should be getting Far Cry 6. We should be covering Call of Duty. There's some pretty big movie and box sets that are coming out later on this year we should be talking about. It's going to be an exciting time to be talking about geek media because let's face it, 2021 was another punch in the face of a year. This year to be over with.
It was very much like everybody thought that 2020 was going to be rough on games. And it turns out it was actually this year where everything really hit the fan. It's all remakes. It's all remasters. And then the odd new property and the few games that are higher budget are all coming out in October and November. And then everything else is looking like 2022 is going to be insane when it comes to like you're gonna have to really budget your money.
Yeah, like it's gonna be an insane little while. I mean, I know once February hits next year, well, I hope you have a lot of Valentine's, folks, because there's gonna be a lot of games to play, but it's gonna be fun too. So hopefully as things move forward, as you're listening to this, I think you're gonna be hearing this on Monday. If you are in Canada, you can still vote for the next couple of hours. Please do so. And as I mentioned last time, make an informed decision. I'm not going to tell you which way to vote because that's just not the way I want to do things. But I want you to make the vote that is right for you.
I'm only going to tell you to vote for somebody that's actually in your riding.
Yeah. Vote for somebody who's in your riding and vote for someone who's not going to hurt somebody. And I think that's important because there's a lot of issues going on around. There's a lot of talking points. But most importantly, just make an informed decision. So next week on the show, we got a lot of cool stuff. I just got the newest book for Star Trek Adventures, which is The Shackleton Expanse from Modiphius. And that's their Beta Quadrant sandbox, which has never been kind of detailed. So talks about stuff from the original era, the Next Generation era. There's new alien races. There's new ships. I think Aaron Paulier did some work on it. It's going to be really, really, really neat. Plus, I have Achung Cthulhu. I got Doctor Who's second edition to talk about. I'm working on an interview for that. I just have to get some stuff cleared with the BBC. I'm also reviewing a Star Trek book where I'll be interviewing the author about the original series. And my primary question to him is going to be, I don't like the original series. Can you sell me on it? Because I want to experience it. Because hopefully in a few weeks, Alex will be reviewing the original series on Blu-ray from Paramount Home Entertainment. And I might ask Alex, hey, I want to borrow this. And I'll be asking this author, well, what episodes should I watch? And maybe on Future Imperfect, we'll revisit that. Because not every Star Trek show sells me right away. For example, everybody tells me DS9 is a wonderful show, and I know it's critically acclaimed, but I can't get past the first two seasons. Yet everybody hates Voyager, and I'm rewatching that while listening to the Delta Flyers podcast.
And I'm wondering, because I own the show. I own DS9. But I've seen a pocket of episodes here and there. I think it's season 3 when it becomes episodic.
Yeah, where they start...
Or, serialized, where the first couple seasons is trying to find its footing, from what I've heard. And I remember seeing a lot of season 1, because it was rerun forever, and then bits and pieces of like seasons 5 through 7. There's a lot in the middle that I never saw. So one of these days we should do a watch through.
Mm-hmm, because there's a lot of characters from DS9 that I like. I love Odo. I love Ben Sisko. Garak is one of my favorite Star Trek characters of all time. And they do crossover. Yeah, Quark, Armin Shimmerman.
You can't forget, like, I would say, was out of everybody on the entire show, I would say the four most important people that I can see, like, it isn't even Sisko or, like, the people that you think would be the most important. Yeah, he has his Oracle, whatever crap, but it's like, it's the four most important people are like Miles O'Brien.
Yep.
Which is hilarious because he was like a side character, right? And yep. on TNG. Him, Worf, it's like any for when it comes to Starfleet, and then Quark and Garak.
Yeah. I mean,
those four people are the most important to the overarching story. And you wouldn't think that because you always think it's the captain or the leader that's the most important. And yeah, there's parts of it that are important because it'll focus on him. But like the station is really run by those four people.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of cool things to talk about that. So Future Imperfect, I think this week was the Aliens franchise. I think me and Aaron talked about. We talked about Battletech. We've talked about RoboCop. We just talked about Ed Wood and Plan 9 from Outer Space on Loose Cannon. Those will be coming back real soon because I did a lot of these while Alex was on vacation. So the timing of those episodes may sound a little strange, but don't worry. We did record them in a proper order.
They're evergreen.
Exactly.
They aren't new franchise. Ed Wood is not making any more movies, right? So
yeah. Although, yeah, like we've got a lot of cool things coming up. I know as October approaches, we have already recorded our show with James Rolfe, the Angry Video Game Nerd. We'll be releasing that on Halloween. But each week during October, we're going to revisit classic episodes we recorded with James, you know, because it's fun. And we're going to do a horror movie commentary, which Alex is currently has pre-ordered via Shout Factory, the Halloween 3 Season of the Witch. We're going to see that in 4K.
Yeah, I figured you said, hey, let's watch it. It's available on Blu-ray. I said, can we wait a couple of weeks? Because there's a 4K copy coming, and I've never seen the movie, so why not watch it in the best quality possible?
Exactly. I love Tom Atkins. It's a great story. I think Ronnie Cox? I don't know. Or Dan O'Hurley. Yeah, Dan O'Hurley is in it. So there's going to be a lot of RoboCop connections and Night of the Creeps. So it's going to be fun. I'm really, really looking forward to it. October is obviously my birthday month where I turn 40 years old. I don't know what to expect for turning 40, but it's
going
to be
gray hairs on your balls.
Thank you. But yeah, so
when my dad turned 40, we got him a birthday card that just said any gray hairs yet. And it was a picture of a cartoon man looking down at his boxers.
So yeah, we've got a lot of good stuff coming up on the show. So once again, thank you guys for supporting us for so long. We definitely appreciate it. And while we may not be the most popular podcast in the world, we're definitely, I would count us among some of the most passionate. Well,
we're the most important podcast that we're on.
Yes.
That's technically
I will agree to that. I will agree to that. So folks, like I said, do your civic duty. Do that tomorrow if you can. But most importantly, be excellent to each other. Treat everybody as you would want to be treated. And have yourselves a good week. So without any further ado, we have been
Alex the producer.
I've been Mike the Birdman saying, be excellent to each other. We'll catch you guys next week right here on ThisWeekInGeek.net.
At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought.
Thanks for listening to this episode of This Week in Geek. Hungry for more? Check out our website at ThisWeekInGeek.net. You can subscribe to the podcast, browse our Twitter and Instagram, and leave your thoughts on today's topics. If you'd like to give us some feedback, send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. Tune in next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
We would be honored if you would join us.
Thank you for your cooperation. Good night.
I did not have this experience. Thank you.
You're not a city boy.
I'm not a city boy.
Then again, I guess I'm not that much of a city boy because I am going.
Yeah. So our last.
I was like, why? Like, is in different. I'm like, well, I'm not going. Fuck is wrong with you? And then walking away.
Yikes.
The preceding recording was deemed not safe for life and has been censored to save all those involved from any form of embarrassment and or the ire of the internet at large.